Thank you. I will also talk about species identification, so I can skip some of the introduction slides. It's about the numerous proposals for its important to species identification forensics. But I will talk about the use of massive parallel sequencing, which is our approach. And this is ongoing work, so it's preliminary results that I will show you. We have about why it's important to have methods at Forensic Lab for species identification. I will talk about it in general. I will show some practical examples from our lab in order for you to understand the objective of the methods that we chose to develop. So currently we have our method. It's DNA sequencing based on hard sequencing, or we sequence a short fragment of a 16S microprotein. The most commonly used question is someone found its bone sample or tissue sample in wood, so they want to know if it's a human, because if it's from a human, we need to do stereotyping and so forth. So for that, it's good to know if it's non-human, of course, because they do not need to perform a lot of work. Another issue that is relevant in Sweden, at least, is illegal hunting. There are some species that are killed illegally. Possible crime scenes, blood stains, so we get to blood, and then try to identify which species it is. But we have also more odd cases on us that also are important to know about in order to develop an appropriate method. Some years ago, we had a mummified hand, it was a tissue. The police took it in an apartment and the man was killed for legal trade or crime and knocking. So the police want to know which type of crime this hand came from. We did species identification test and it was shown to be a bear. So this shows the importance that in some cases it's not really what they're looking for, so that, therefore the method should be more universal. Instead of a specific method for each species. And in your other case was a possible rape case. It was a rape that was performed in a crime scene at a park. And the police found sperm cells. And then they started to do the SDR profile, but they never obtained the SDR view and SDR profile, so it was concerned about. Why they did not obtain any such profiles without the sample, and turn off that these sperm cells was not from a human being. So this is good to show that it can save a lot of work. And it also shows you that a universal approach is good to have when it comes to species identification. So as I said before, we have a method. Why do we need a new method? Well, we have the current methods only focus on mammal species, but as we have about non-profitable trading, it can involve also fish and birds and reptiles, non-mammal species, so you need to draw the spectrum. We also need to be able to identify which species within the feature, we have DNA from different species, as we have about biomarkers for attacks, it's relevant to be able to identify also the minor component. And only a couple of years ago, it became illegal in Sweden to also sexually assault animals. And in those cases, where it's often not from the, most often not from the human, it's important that we be able to identify the minor component in the main structure. So, this is, I think, is it. We chose mitochondrial DNA due to some advantages as we heard about, and there's been a lot of work on which to targets to focus on. Since we use MPS, we can choose multiple targets. So in this case, in our new method, we chose three different genes to sequence based on previous works. And as you can see, there are different fragment length expected from these different genes. And before we go to the lab, we need to do So what we did a safety study based on these targets. So we downloaded the reference sequences from almost 4,500 different species, all belong to the certain vertebrate. And the first task was to design the primers and to see, since this is a universal approach, we wanted to be sure that all the primers would appeal to all species. So this is just an example of how it can look like. This is the forward primer, PCR primer, for the 16S RNA fragment. And on the X scale is the base nucleotide position, the primer. And on the Y scale, you can see the differences in variability among the different species when it comes to the nucleotide. So for example, at position 20, you see that almost 20% of the species do have a nucleotide, while other species do have a G nucleotide. So we do need to have deaggregated primers, meaning that we have in the primer mix different primers with different nucleotides at different positions. Especially this is, of course, you know, at the 3' and it's more important that we really can capture all the different species. This is more complex one. So from the reverse primer, as you see at the 3', and there's a lot of differentiation among different species, so also that would be more degenerative primers. So now we have checked that, then we also need to, before this gets started, to look into specificity. How many species can really separate? So you can calculate specificity in different ways. We did it by comparing all different species, and only a few of all 10 million comparisons show that they were identical. But all these species that had identical sequences belong to the same family. For example, all zebras did have the same DNA sequence, but we could not go further down to identify which zebra it was. So now we go to the lab. It's quite straightforward. We amplify the targets using partial PCR. We prepare the libraries using the gene reworker flow from Cadian. And then we sequence the amplicons using the MiSeq. And at the moment, we use a web tool for the bioinformatics. And the final thing is that we lost the sequence to get the actual species. So here are some results from the actual tests that we've done. We have done some tests from different species for different mammals, birds, and fishes, and also different tissue types, blood tissue, muscle tissue, wood swabs, hair samples, and so forth. And in these cases, we could identify the right ones. These are single source samples. But as you see, for some species, we could only identify the factor level, but in most cases, this would be enough. We then wanted also to test on mixed sources, so the artificial mixed DNA from different species. Two species with shared, but also up to four different species within share. And could identify more species, but the ratio was not as expected. So we cannot, with this method at least, make use of the observed ratio to interpret the expected ratio in the sample. And this is due to the fact that the primers mean differently to the different targets for different species, so we have different efficiency in the PCR. So to sum this up, we have now an MPS-based food target method, and we have done simple studies to show that it should work in theory, and we have done some initial tests that verify this as well, but there is much work to do when it comes to validating this for first purpose. For example, the sensitivity, especially for the mixed samples. We also need to correlate any possible PCI views or sequence views, errors,